Welcome to the Behind the Headlines Web Extra. This is the sidebar, which we didn't get to in the regular program. And one of the things that that I wanted to talk about in the sidebar today was the business of Elvis Presley. It is a real economic engine for this city. And you did a cover story about that in the Memphis News, right?
Yes. This is an interesting time for Graceland and for the Elvis legacy. We live in an age of intellectual property, something that probably existed when Elvis Presley was alive, but which we didn't call intellectual property or which we didn't really focus on as a source of continuing income. The reason I say Graceland is at an interesting place is because it's now had its fourth owner in a seven-year period. Mm-hmm. An equity firm called Apollo Global Management out of New York now owns CKX, the company that not only owns the image and legacy of Elvis in terms of financial gain, but it also produces the American Idol television program, and So You Want to Dance. And CKX is an entertainment.
Do you think you can dance?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
That tells you how much I watch.
Yeah, that's full nice.
But at any rate, CKX is an entertainment company. Mm-hmm. And basically, from the time that it bought 85% of Elvis Presley Enterprises in 2005, it looked at what was happening and said, there can be Elvis themed nightclubs in other places. In fact, in Whitehaven, there shouldn't just be Graceland and Graceland Plaza across the street. There should be basically an Elvis resort, a $250 million project that would widen the Elvis bubble in Whitehaven and which would also have resulting impact economically on the rest of the business strip between Brooks Road and Shelby Drive that I think everyone in Memphis knows
right.
is not really Elvis related, but is basically an economic engine.
It sounds like an Elvis Disney World where you have standards
right.
for each of the companies so that none of the individual companies can wander off into the weeds and damage the brand in any way.
Right.
Yeah.
But you would also have local merchants there as well, so you would have the economic revitalization of Whitehaven overall. Mm-hmm. And that's stalled in the recession, but the city is about to go ahead with planning for renewing that strip in terms of things like moving the utility poles and the wires further away from the street, having a more coherent plan for non-Elvis related businesses that do come into the area, trying to attract retail on that kind of level for Whitehaven as a whole. And of course, Whitehaven is what we think about here in Memphis when we talk about the Elvis phenomenon. That's the neighborhood, even if the rest of the world doesn't know what the neighborhood is called, that's what we know it as.
Sorely needed. I mean, it's the number one of the top two tourist attractions in the city.
Yeah.
In the city over the years has basically paid no attention. None.
Yeah, because you go into that area and there were some abandoned stores.
There's crazy zoning.
Like
they've let in gas stations selling fried chicken right across the street from, I mean, it's just a city planners and officials years ago never really recognized this for what it is and for what it can be. And so you drive out there and you just have this mishmash of, I mean, I don't know what else to call it. It's just a mishmash of stuff.
What amounts to Whitehaven's Main Street.
That's right. You know,
Jackson.
I'm going to do a tangent off Bill's use of the term neighborhood. Well, we're talking about a neighborhood, developing a neighborhood, but the neighbors in the neighborhood do come from the entire world. I've stopped by again this year. I skipped a couple of years, but every now and then I try to keep my hand in and see who shows up for Elvis Week. And they still come from Germany and France and North and South
India.
And East and West, everywhere.
It's amazing.
And there's a new crop of 16 and 17-year-olds. I know where they come from, but they pick up on the gospel of Elvis and they're there. The crowds aren't any smaller than they used to be. And speaking of the business of Elvis, at Rotary Club last week, Kevin Kane was the speaker, and he made it clear that he went through all of the great advances we've made, the renaissance of downtown and so forth. He said all of it, every bit of it, stems from Elvis Presley.
But
he was the impetus, the energy for every other bit of expansion there was. He gives him full credit.
But all these decades after his death, the folks who are minding the store of the Elvis image are concerned, and I think rightly so, for moving off of the five-year anniversary track that they've been on basically since about the early 80s.
And look, they need help at Graceland with the exhibits. I mean, they have 1970s era projection screens. I mean, not much has changed inside
but the Graceland
those
itself,
gates.
Graceland itself can't first change that much or it won't be Elvis.
Right.
That's the
but
one
the
thing
exhibits
that's
can. Yeah. I mean, they need help.
Well, I'm going to run to the next topic here, and it's become a soap opera a little bit with the with the Memphis City Council. You pointed out last week in the sidebar that there was a what was it a bylaw that
well
was
well
added.
What happened was, and I thought I'd have a different sidebar this week, but we're back. This is chapter two of that one. What I said last week, I pointed out that the city council had passed a resolution,
right,
8-0. The people who were still there to constitute a quorum from the previous meeting, they were so angry that at the loquaciousness of two members who had spoken for huge amounts of time and then left and forced them to miss National Night Out, the places they wanted to be, that they passed a resolution 8-0 limiting all members on any given topic to 5 minutes. That's all.
It's interesting.
And that has never happened before to have that kind of limitation.
Those are actually in Robert's Rules of Order. Those rules were already in place.
Well, now they're going to start enforcing
no more than 5 minutes, on each topic, but no one had ever...
Had ever enforced it.
Now they're on notice.
So it seemed arbitrary to some of the members of the council.
So here is chapter two, though. Chapter two comes from the fact that Wanda Halbert, who was one of the two members they were taking exception to, she and Joe Brown, to get it out there. And indeed, if you go online and listen to the conversations, that both of them talked an awful long time about an issue that could have been dealt with briefer.
Accepted grant funds, I believe.
Well, yeah. So basically, Wanda took exception to this and wrote a very angry email to Myron Lowry, the chairman, sent one to all the other council people, saying how, this is silly, this is ridiculous. Somebody needed to put up for those issues. How dare you change the procedures? Myron waits about a week and he sends an email back and he says, how dare you? You do not have the respect of, the reason no one has answered your emails is you do not have the respect of your council colleagues, which I think was something that was generally suspected, but he voiced it. And then he said, there's no doubting why we can't be a team with someone as irrational as you, that kind of thing. She responds saying, well, this is another case of calling women irrational. And there are a lot of pent-up resentments that all began to surface, but there has been a certain resentment on the council toward one faction against another, and that's what's bubbling out now.
I see. Well, we're going to leave it there for this week. Thank you for joining us on the Behind the Headlines Web Extra.